Hallo liebe Kampanisten, Svenja und ich sind wieder mal unterwegs und jetzt gerade vor der Friedrich-Ebert-Stiftung in Berlin, weil wir nämlich gleich auf Professorin Mariana Mazzucato treffen werden, die heute den Hans-Matthöfer-Preis für Wirtschaftspublizistik entgegennehmen wird. Kurz zu ihrer Person, bevor wir da gleich reingehen. Sie ist Professorin in Sussex für Wissenschaft und Wirtschaft, besonders mit dem Fokus Technologie und ökonomisches Wachstum. Den Preis für Wirtschaftspublizistik bekommt sie für ihr Buch The Entrepreneurial State und da räumt sie zum Beispiel auf mit dem Mythos, dass der Staat nur Regulationsmedium ist, sondern sagt vielmehr, das ist eigentlich der allergrößte Entrepreneur, den es halt hier gibt. Gerade wir in Berlin kennen den Staat ja schon irgendwo als der, der immer dazwischen funkt und alle paar Monate ein neues Gesetz auf den Weg bringt. Und ich bin sehr gespannt, was sie dazu zu sagen hat.
I come from Companista, which is the market leader in private equity in Germany, Austria and Switzerland. You in your book, The Entrepreneurial State, you ask the question why there's still non-European Google or Amazon or Apple. So why is that so?
Well, normally the answer to that question is that we don't have enough venture capital, or we don't have enough, you know, sort of bankruptcy laws that enable people to take risks and not worry about failure. And whereas my answer is, yeah, you know, those might be some factors, but actually what enabled Google and Apple and many of these companies to come about was actually public financing in the very early stage. There's very little venture capital, very few business angels even in the very, very early stage high risk area. So innovation is extremely risky. Most attempts fail. And it also takes a long, long time from start, literally from when an idea comes about to when it actually comes to market, even 30 years can pass. So the question for finance is who's going to actually cover that very early stage high risk area? And the answer around the world, from Israel to Finland, to Denmark, to Silicon Valley, has been the public sector. And this is not about public good, private bad. It's simply reality. It's historically a fact that it's mainly been public financing, which has come in the very early stage, high risk, capital intensive area. And the private sector only comes in later.
You're talking about Apple as well. So that Apple and the iPhone with the touchscreen and stuff like that, it doesn't really tell the story that the government was actually involved in the investments, in the early investments.
The company itself got very early stage money through the SBIC program, Small Business Innovation Corporation program.
Right.
There's also an equivalent program called SBIR, which has given huge amounts of money to companies like Compaq and Intel, to the company itself, just to set up. In the case of Apple, I think it was early 1970s, they got $500,000. It's not a huge amount, but you know, Tesla today got $500 million from the same sort of kind of fund. So the point is, that's the money that's coming in very early stage just to set up the company. Now, what Apple actually then did, created lots of different smart products. Of course, there's very smart people in Apple, but the point is what they ended up doing was applying design, you know, a great sense of design, which is very important. People underestimate the importance of design. It's very important. However, they put together existing technologies. They actually didn't invest in any of the technologies themselves, which is fine. There's no problem with that. But the problem is, again, the storytelling that we then have of Apple is this, you know, garage tinkering kind of business, which had all these geniuses inside and came up with these great technologies. Well, it's completely false. They used existing publicly funded technologies and put them together in really cool ways into different, you know, iProducts. Fine. But so then you have the problem of who's going to be able to do that again in the future if these existing technologies are no longer being financed by governments around the world that are choking because they no longer have money. Both because of austerity policies, but also because of what's happening to tax. So companies like Apple, Google, and Amazon not paying their fair share of tax that goes into the public finances, which then can play this game over and over and over, as opposed to a one-shot game.
Is there anything more than just the early stage investments an entrepreneurial state needs?
So when I talk about an entrepreneurial state, what I actually mean is risk-taking. We pretend that the government just de-risks business. We forget to say it actually invests directly and in doing so takes big risks. And it's not just early stage. These investments are both in the very early stage area of basic research as well as applied research and the synergies between them, as well as early stage financing of companies. That's the whole innovation chain. On top of that, policies, which then enable these new products when they actually come about to get fully diffused throughout the economy. That's about, you know, different, whether it's tax incentives, you know, that enable purchases of particular products for consumers. So the role of government is everywhere. It's in the early stage of the supply side, it's in the middle, it's in the company financing itself, it's also in the policies that do the demand pull. Right. Now, all of this takes, you know, all of that is risk-taking because there's risks all along that phase. And so for me, the entrepreneurial state is simply to change the way we talk about the state instead of just regulator, spender, administrator. You're an investor. And if you're an investor, you're going to take big risks and you're also going to fail. Yeah. So you have to welcome failure, welcome risk-taking, but also share in the rewards.
It's not really like, as we know, Germany. Like every 4 months, there's going to be a new law with no one expected. So let it be private equity or let it be exits.
But what's wrong with laws?
There's nothing wrong with it, mm-hmm. but people don't talk with each other. Like the politics don't really talk with the startups, or they do it later on. Like they talk with the startups in the later stage when they're already...
More engagement, you think there should be. There should be laws to manage and shape that process. What you're then suggesting, which I think is a very important point, is those laws that are introduced, they should be smart, they should actually be results of engagement, perhaps with business, but also with academia, with consumers, in terms of understanding what the consequences might be, for example, of these new rules. That's fundamental. But this constant complaint that we hear, oh, the government's just coming out all the time with this red tape, that's part of the myth. Because if you are a co-creator in a system, you know, for example, the examples I give in the book is huge government funding, which actually created the biotechnology industry, actually created it. Without, you know, 40 years of National Institute of Health funding, the Kleiner Perkins of this world, a big venture capital fund, would have had nothing to invest in. So if you've actually co-created something, of course, you have the right to then shape it through different types of regulations, which are going to ensure that the taxpayer, but society at large, benefits. So it's good we have laws. Then the problem is which kind of laws, what kind of engagement in order to get the smart kind. Yeah. But that's very different from saying, oh, government, bunch of bureaucrats coming out with all these laws all the time.
Yeah, well, we're always scared to lose the attraction as one of the places to be for startups and entrepreneurs because of the laws coming up twice a year.
How many more laws come out in Berlin than come out in London, Tokyo, or Milan?
How many laws in a year?
I doubt it's much more. I think what you're saying, which again, I think is a really valid point, is that sometimes the lawmaking process is too maybe disconnected from, you know, maybe some evidence on the floor of how to actually, you know, shape these laws. And really, I think the main point is as soon as you start having an objective, like what do you want to do in Germany? Do we want to have a great life sciences sector? We want to be leaders in nanotechnology, or we want this energy van policy to transform green and all sorts of different sectors. Then, you know, business and government and the trade unions have to come together to talk about how to share, if you want, the risks that are going to be required to do that. But just sort of talking about government as lawmaking, I think also dismisses so many public investments in Germany that have been made, which have benefited companies, which if they want government to stand back, then they should be willing to do without those investments.
Right, that's the mission you're talking about, right?
No, but it's also, you can't have it both ways. Yeah, you can't both have government constantly doing what the private sector is not willing to do. And then as soon as the profits come about, you want government to step back and just, you know, have no laws that which are about shaping the process in such a way that it actually makes sense for everybody, not just, you know, free riding.
Right, okay, cool. Yeah. Thanks. Ja, das Taxi hat uns gerade wieder abgesetzt. Jetzt sind wir wieder bei uns hier im Büro und hatten die Taxifahrt natürlich Zeit, kurz drüber nachzudenken. Das Interview war insgesamt nur 10 Minuten lang. Das ist wenig Zeit, um wirklich Fragen zu fragen. Aber jetzt mal zur konkreten Problematik. Der Staat als Innovator oder der Staat als Regulator. Was Mariana Mazzucato gesagt hat, dass es jetzt in Amerika ziemlich klar ist. Also eigentlich investiert der Staat sehr oft, sehr früh. Ich weiß nicht genau, ob das auch mit Deutschland gleichzusetzen ist, weil bei uns zum Beispiel das Existenzförderprogramm auch nur ein Jahr dauert. Und Gründer werden, nachdem sie von der Uni kommen, nur ein Jahr lang gefördert. Und ich frage mich, ob das diese Innovation ist, diese Innovationskraft, die vom Staat ausgeht, die Mariana Mazzucato meint. Und ich bin sehr gespannt, was ihr dazu sagt. Ist der Staat bei uns eher Regulationsinstrument oder eher der größte Existenzgründer im Lande?